Passive Solar Simplified, Part 3, by Thomas Doerr. The second type of passive solar system we will talk about is indirect gain. Indirect gain systems heat a dense material in the house's wall or roof, and this heat is then conducted through the material into the living space. The most common type of indirect gain system is the thermal storage wall, diagrammed here. In the heating condition, on the left, the low winter sun sends its energy through the glass collector, it hits the absorber, a mass wall, and this heat is slowly conducted through the wall into the living space, as opposed to a direct gain system where the sun's energy would go directly into the living space. Thermal storage walls delay the heat to keep the house warm throughout the night. In the cooling condition, on the right, the high summer sun is blocked from the collector by solar shading. We'll talk more about solar shading in the strategies section. High and low windows are opened, allowing hot air to naturally rise and escape, pulling cool air through the space, keeping occupants comfortable in the summer. Thermal storage walls are great for spaces that you do not want lots of daylight in, such as rooms for video editing. If you have privacy concerns, thermal storage walls are great for spaces you don't want a window into, and they give rooms more wall space. Thermal storage walls are usually more expensive than direct gain systems because you have to build a heavy extra wall and foundation behind the south glass. Thermal storage walls glass should be about 2 to 6 inches in front of the mass wall. This mass wall should have a dark surface facing the glass and should be about 8 to 18 inches thick. Thermal storage walls are often made out of grout-filled concrete blocks, but can also be stone, concrete, brick, and other dense materials. A variation on the thermal storage wall is a trombe wall. Trombe walls work similarly, but they also circulate air through the mass wall to the living space. It's best to avoid trombe walls since they can have problems with reverse heat loss in the winter, as well as problems with moisture and cleaning. The way we determine the area of thermal storage wall is by first finding the house site's latitude and mean winter temperature. Then we use this table to find the closest latitude in the row on the top and find the closest temperature in the column on the left. We then connect the latitude column and the temperature row to see the percentage of thermal storage wall to conditioned floor area. For example, for Moab, Utah at a latitude of almost 39 degrees north with a mean winter temperature of 31 degrees Fahrenheit, in this table on the top row, find the closest to latitude 39 degrees, 40 degrees, and the closest to 31 degrees Fahrenheit in the left column, 30 degrees. Connect these and the chart indicates a ratio of 0.53. For a 2,000 square foot home, multiply this 2,000 by 0.53 and you'll see you require 1,060 square feet of thermal storage wall. The higher the latitude and the lower the winter temperature of a site, the more thermal storage wall area required. Here is an example of an indirect gain system. This is the thermal storage wall at NREL, that's the National Renewable Energy Laboratory in Golden, Colorado. And you can see the slide's a little dark, but you see on the picture on the left where you have the glass and it's about 4 inches in front of the concrete block, which is filled with grout. It's very important that it not be hollow. That would create an insulatory barrier to the heat. And then what's interesting about NREL is it also uses direct gain in the same space. So in the morning they get direct gain, in the afternoon they collect that heat in the thermal storage wall to heat the space all night. The third type of passive solar system we're going to look at is the isolated gain system. And then we're going to look at two types of isolated gain system, the first being the sunspace. Now, sunspaces are like an attached greenhouse. They use convection to take hot air into the living space. If you look at the winter diagram down in the left, you see the sun going through the glass collector, hitting the absorber, which heats the air. The hot air rises and goes into the living space. As it cools, it falls and goes back into the sunspace to be heated again. It's extremely efficient. In the summer, for the cooling condition on the right, the sun heats up the sunspace again, the hot air rises, but this time it's the hot air is directed outside, which creates a vacuum which will pull air through the living space, cooling it off. So one thing one has to note about sunspaces is they cannot be occupied all the time because they have such extreme temperatures. Even in the winter they can get very hot, in the summer they're extremely hot, and at night in the winter they, with all the glass, they can cool off quite chilly. So, and another couple things you need to note is sunspaces can block southern light and views from the living spaces. An example of a sunspace is a Bean Jackson house in Denver, Colorado. The Bean Jackson house was a beautiful 1908 Victorian energy hog. And Doerr Architecture wanted to preserve the character of the house. Instead of adding insulation to the walls and knocking out walls to add large windows to get passive solar gain, we added the sunspace. You can see on the photograph on the left, towards the back of the house, and then that sunspace will generate a lot of heat, which will be ducted into the old part of the house. And so even if it wastes the energy, at least it's free energy it's wasting. Another aspect of the Bean Jackson house is it's a great portion of the addition is actually direct gain passive solar, but these photos are here to show what a sunspace can look like. You can see the interior of one on the photograph on the right. The second type of isolated gain system we're going to talk about is the thermosiphon. Thermosiphons also use convection to take the hot air into the living space, just like the sunspaces do. You see in the winter diagram on the left, for a heating condition, the sun goes through the collector, which is usually glass, hits the absorber, dark metal or something. And then what's very efficient about thermosiphons is, of course, hot air wants to rise and it comes in low into the living space. And of course, as it cools, it falls and it'll go back into the thermosiphon to be heated again. In the summer, for the cooling condition, just like the sunspace, the air is heated. And then it's, instead of going into the living space, it's directed outside, which creates a vacuum in the thermosiphon, pulling cool air through the space. Now, the thermosiphons are the most efficient system, but they're also the most expensive because you have to build this you have to build the thermosiphon out in front of the building.